And the common question that I get asked and you get asked, and you saw my little video, which I think explained it pretty well, is whey versus NAC. Ah. The classic question that I get all the time, of course, and I will let you explain the why whey should be superior as a glutathione precursor than NAC. Of course, both have their places, I think, as you said, and NAC is an effective clinical drug in the right places. But explain to people the difference between whey and NAC, or at least why one should be. They're not equal, I guess, is my point. They're not interchangeable, in my view.
Well, I know you know the answer, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to explain it. First, let me say that NAC is a life-saving drug. If I'm in the emergency department and I have an acetaminophen overdose or somebody in fulminant hepatic failure, I'm going to use N-acetylcysteine. Now, the doses that I use in an emergency situation are monstrously higher than the doses that you're going to find in a health food store.
Nice.
And I know that I'm going to make the patient really sick with the N-acetylcysteine, but I'd rather have a sick patient than a dead patient. Okay. So it's a very, very useful drug, and let's call it a drug. It's not a natural product.
Mm-hmm.
The big difference is that one is a drug and it does a specific thing. N-acetylcysteine will raise your glutathione levels. A whey protein isolate like Immunocal, it's not a drug. It's food. It will supply, first of all, every single essential amino acid that you need. It will supply glutathione precursors that are shielded from destruction, so what you're eating will actually turn into glutathione. And there are dozens, if not hundreds, of other biologically active components that you will find in whey that you mentioned even at the beginning of the show that do remarkable things. Yeah. A lot of them we don't even know about.
Well, lactoferrin, of course, is one that we do know, but as you said, there's still plenty of peptides that have yet to even be examined, if not discovered. I'm going to even make the leap that we know all the peptides in there, but even if
peptides, things that lower your blood pressure and on and on and on. Now, on a biochemical level, and I won't get too deep because it's hard to do without mapping it out on a diagram. One thing that most people don't know about N-acetylcysteine. You see, why don't you just eat cysteine? Why not just eat cysteine? Because cysteine doesn't work. It becomes oxidized very quickly.
Yeah.
And it, just like vitamin C, if you take too much cysteine, you end up in a pro-oxidant state. So what you do chemically to the cysteine is you add a little side chain to it, an acetyl chain and acetylcysteine. You add a little side chain which protects it from being oxidized. So people think, okay, the cysteine is being protected from being oxidized. Not really. What you've done, you've stopped about 15% of the cysteine from being oxidized. And that 15% is what's at work to make glutathione. The other 85% is oxidized, and it's the oxidized cysteine that actually gives you the side effects that you get from taking N-acetylcysteine, like nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're taking N-acetylcysteine, about 15% of it is actually going to make it to be turned into glutathione.
The part that sort of always, that I just fascinated me from the biochemical part when I explain it to people, is that also that, of course, that cysteine or N-acetylcysteine has to go through a two enzymatic step to become glutathione, whereas the peptides, at least the two peptides, cysteine and glutamyl cysteine peptide, which has always been my personal favorite, are passed, jump over that one enzymatic step that is the rate limiting step. And for people that don't understand, that means that the there's always an enzyme that kind of is the control gate for stuff. Well, the peptides in whey go jump past that limiting step to produce.
And again, just to dumb it down, mm-hmm. glutathione is made up of three amino acids, cysteine, glutamine, and glycine. Okay. So when you're taking away, first of all, you're getting all three amino acids. When you're taking N-acetylcysteine, the cysteine has to be joined up to another amino acid, glutamate. So as Will is saying, it takes an enzyme to join those two. And then the cysteine and glutamate need to be joined up with glycine, which requires another step. When you take whey, if it's undenatured, like Immunocal, you are getting cysteine, but you're also getting cystine, which is two cysteines linked together, and you're also getting gamma-glutamyl cysteine. So you've done away with one of the steps. It's at least, well, probably more, but at least half as easy for that cysteine to be turned into glutathione. Not only is it at least half as easy, you also, if you're taking N-acetylcysteine, you have to make sure that you have an ample supply of the other two amino acids.
That's another rate limiting, that would be another at least synthesis limiting issue.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So somebody like a cancer patient or an AIDS patient, mm-hmm. Who can be in a starvation state.
Right.
They ain't getting that cysteine and glycine, that glutamate and glycine that easy.
Well, they're not getting from the insurer they feed them, that's for sure.